water. In first test tube, you add boiled and cooked rice. In the second test tube, you add boiled and chewed rice. The chewed rice is broken down into small pieces with the help of teeth and it mixes with the saliva. Then you start adding iodine drop by drop into both the test tubes. Which test tube changes color? Definitely the boiled and the chewed rice is in whichever test tube the boiled and chewed rice is present, that changes color. Because of the presence of an enzyme secreted by salivary gland known as salivary amylase. Because of the presence of salivary amylase, saliva breaks down the starch into sugars. That is the effect of saliva on the starch. In the chewed rice, it is mixed with saliva, right? This saliva attacks on the starch. How it breaks down the starch into sugar. So this experiment proves the action of saliva on the starch. This is about action of saliva on the starch. Experiment to prove the action of saliva on the starch. The test tube in which the chewed rice is present is mixed with the salivary enzyme called salivary amylase. That changes color when the iodine is added, thereby indicating that saliva acts on the starch to break down into sugars. So, from the mouth of the buccal cavity, next the food moves into the food pipe, also known as the esophagus. So, in this food pipe, the swallowed food moves down from the esophagus. From the tongue, the swallowed food moved down, right? It moved down into the esophagus. Then esophagus runs along the neck up to the chest. From the neck up to the chest, the food pipe or the esophagus runs. And then food is moved by the walls of the esophagus. There are certain walls in the esophagus which moves the food. Then occurs continuously until the food reaches the alimentary canal. So this movement of the food in the wall of the esophagus occurs continuously till the food reaches the alimentary canal or the stomach. Then sometimes, have you wondered why vomiting occurs? Because there are certain walls in the stomach which sometimes allow these walls of the stomach always allows the food to be moved downwards into the stomach intestines. But sometimes these walls, the food which is not accepted by the stomach, repels back into the throat. The wall opens and the food is repelled back into the throat and it is not accepted by your stomach, which results in vomiting. So esophagus moves the swallowed food further down into the alimentary canal. It moves the food continuously until the food reaches the alimentary canal. And if sometimes the vomiting occurs because the food is not accepted by the stomach and it repels back into the throat via the walls of the esophagus. Now from this esophagus, food further moves down into the stomach. Stomach is a thick walled bag-like structure. It is a U-shaped structure and it is the widest part of this alimentary canal. The small intestine, stomach, everything together make up alimentary canal. And the stomach is the widest part of the alimentary canal. And the stomach has two ends. The first end is open, receives food from the intestine. Stomach has two ends. The first end or the front end receives the food from the intestine. And the other end, the next end, opens into the small intestine. It further moves the food into the small intestine. And this stomach has inner lining. What does inner lining secretes? The inner lining of the stomach secretes mucus, which makes it slippery in structure, which makes it wet, makes the surface very wet and slippery, mucus. And how this mucus helps? This mucus protects the lining of the stomach. It acts as the lining of the stomach, this mucus. And also contains HCl or hydrochloric acid. What is the action of this acid? This acid kills the bacteria that enter along with the food. So this hydrochloric acid kills the bacteria that enter along with the food. And then it makes the medium of the stomach acidic. Suppose it's a medium of any substance is always either acidic or alkaline. Alkaline is also known as basic. So if the medium of the stomach is basic, this hydrochloric acid makes it acidic. Sometimes you have hyperacidity, you have burning in the stomach, then you take things like that, tablets, or you take liquids like enosachets, you take digest, or what else you take? You take Gelucil, you take Daiji, you obviously follow some home remedies. It's because of the disturbances in the acidic content of the stomach, you get hyperacidity. That is, HCl acid is present in the stomach that kills the bacteria and makes the medium of the stomach acidic. So suppose if you take spicy foods or extremely oily foods or more amount of masalas in your food, you get acidity feeling in your stomach, the burning sensation of the stomach. that is because of the HCl or hydrochloric acid. Then stomach lining also secretes digestive juices. What is the function of these digestive juices? It breaks down these digestive juices break down the proteins into the smaller substances. The protein which come from the food is broken down into smaller substances with the help of the digestive juice. So here in the stomach the digestion process occurs. From stomach the food moves into the small intestine where the absorption of the food occurs. From the stomach the food further moves into the small intestine as the stomach other end of the stomach opens into small intestine. Small intestine is 7.5 meters long coiled structure. Then it receives secretions both from liver and pancreas. Liver is situated above the abdomen and pancreas is situated below the stomach, and it also has some digestive juices. And from the liver it receives bile juice. Liver is the largest gland of the body and it secretes something called bile juice, and it is stored in a sac-like structure called gallbladder. So this small intestine receives secretions from liver. What does liver secrete? Liver secrete bile juice. This bile juice is stored in the form of a sac-like structure called gallbladder. Moving on to pancreas. And what is the action of the bile juice? Bile juice helps in digestion of the fats. So moving on to pancreas. Pancreas are situated below the stomach and they help in digestion of carbohydrates, fats and proteins. So liver helps in digestion of the fats. Pancreas helps in digestion of the carbohydrates, fats and proteins. So this small intestine receives secretions both from liver and the pancreas. Pancreas secrete a hormone called insulin. Pancreas have something organ called islets of Langerhans in them. These islets of Langerhans secrete insulin. So pancreas secrete insulin. So this insulin also helps in some part of the digestion. Imbalance in the secretion of insulin results in a disease called diabetes or sugar, which many of you might have known that your elders have been affected. Then the further digestion is completed by the presence of these digestive juices. So what are these carbohydrates which are secreted by these pancreas are further converted into sugary substances called glucose. So the carbohydrates which are digested in the stomach and small intestine are converted into glucose. Glucose is nothing but a form of a sugar. Then this glucose in the presence of oxygen in the cells gets further converted into carbon dioxide and water and gives energy. So the carbohydrate is converted into smaller sugary substances called glucose, and this glucose in the cells in the presence of oxygen get converted into carbon dioxide and water. And the fats, the digested fats get converted into fatty acids and the glycerol, and the digested proteins convert into amino acids. And other than this, the small intestine has a very unique feature called villi. They have something called villi. These villi are finger-like outgrowths present in the stomach. Villi are finger-like outgrowths present in the stomach, which are having blood vessels. So in the walls of the small intestine, the food further gets mixed up with the blood vessels. It gets and goes and gets absorbed by the blood vessels. These villi are present in the blood vessels. Villi are finger-like, hair-like growth having blood vessels. So these villi, what is the function of these villi? They help in absorption of the food further by increasing the surface area of absorption. These villi increase the surface area of absorption and helps in further absorption of the food. Then these absorbed substances in the villi are further transported into various organs of the body via blood vessels. All the absorbed substances in the stomach in the villi are further transported to various organs of the body via blood vessels. In these various organs of the body, these absorb substances like proteins help in building the energy required for the body. So this process is called assimilation. So absorption and then assimilation is the next process. Villi also helps in absorption, and further these absorbed substances are carried out to the various organs of the body via blood vessels, which further give energy to the body. This process is known as assimilation. After the digestion and assimilation and absorption by the small intestine, the undigested material, lots of maximum amount of the food gets digested. The remaining undigested food matter moves into the large intestine. So large intestine is a wider, shorter, and it is only 1.5 meters long. Whereas small intestine was 7.5 meters long, large intestine is 1.5 meters long. The function of large intestine is to absorb the water and the salts from the undigested material it has received. to absorb the water and salts from the undigested food material it has received. Then this undigested food further passes into something called rectum. Rectum is also a part of the large intestine. This rectum further opens into the anus, from which you defecate or pass stools. So the undigested food passes into the rectum, then coming it further moves into the anus. In this anus, semi-solid undigested food present in the form of feces moves from the rectum and is removed out through the anus. So this process is called digestion. The removal of the undigested food via anus is called digestion. Sometimes you get diarrhea. Diarrhea is nothing but loose motions. Why? Because of eating either outside food, undigested food or poisonous food substances. That time you have the urge of passing loose motions. That is known as diarrhea. Before you go to a doctor, what you should do when you get a diarrhea, you have to take ORS or oral rehydrating solution packets. You get those readymade. You get those packets over the counter in the medical shops. If you do not have them handy, then you have to mix some amount of sugar and salt into the water and drink it. That accounts for ORS solution, oral rehydrating solution, in the situations when you get attacked with diarrhea or loose motions. So this is about the digestion in human beings. Now we should move into the digestion in animals. How does digestion occur in grass-eating animals? What are the grass-eating animals? Cow, sheep, goat, buffalo, etc. So you might have observed camel. Whenever animals get grass, they eat it very fast and store it in a sac-like structure called rumen. And whenever they are free, they sit and keep chewing. Even when they are not eating, the animals, whenever they are in rest position under the trees, you always see their mouth. They are always chewing the food. So these animals, grass-eating animals, quickly swallow the grass and store it in a structure called rumen. It is a sac-like structure. So this rumen is further leads to the food which is taken by the rumen is known as curd, C-U-D, curd. So from the rumen, the food is known as curd. Here partial digestion of the food occurs. But when the animal is not eating and in a rest position, this curd returns back to the mouth in the form of small lumps for the further digestion. Then they, from the mouth, animals further chew it. So you see, whenever animals are in the resting position, like cows, buffaloes, camels, they keep chewing the food. They get food back to their mouth and keep chewing it. So animals, whenever they eat grass, it is stored in a sac-like structure called rumen. In the rumen, the food is known as curd. It is a partially digested food. This partially digested food curd comes back into the mouth in the form of small lumps and undergoes further digestion process. So this further digestion process leads the animals to further chew it and gets it digested. So this further chewing and helps in digestion of the food. This process is known as rumination. In this process, in which the animals further chew the cud and swallow it, is known as rumination. And animals which undergo this process are known as ruminants. Ruminants are animals which take the food immediately and store it in the rumen in the form of cud. And these cud comes back to the mouth and the animals further chew it and then digest it. These animals which do this type of process for eating is known as ruminant animals. And this process of chewing the food is known as rumination. So this grass, the animals what eat, they eat grass. Grass is rich in cellulose. Cellulose is nothing but carbohydrates. But these animals can digest this cellulose, but whereas human beings can never digest this cellulose. How this cellulose is digested? There is a sac-like structure known as cecum present between the small intestine and the large intestine of the animals. So cecum is a sac-like structure between small and large intestine of the animals. This cecum helps in the digestion of cellulose by the action of certain bacteria. So the grass they eat is in the form of cellulose or carbohydrate. This cellulose is digested with the help of a sac-like structure called cecum. In human beings, we do not have cecum. We can never digest cellulose. Whereas in animals, they have cecum which helps in digestion of this cellulose or the starch or the carbohydrate content which is present in the grass. This digestion of cellulose is done with the help of the action of certain bacteria. So this is about digestion in grass-eating animals. Moving on to the digestion in amoeba. Amoeba is a unicellular organism. It is irregular in shape. It keeps changing its shape. It has cell in it, you know, right? So this amoeba has finger-like projections known as pseudopodia, artificial legs, can you say? So it pushes out those finger-like projections called pseudopodia or false feet. So this animal, this amoeba, is a unicellular organism, irregular in shape. It has a false feet-like structure called pseudopodia. So this pushes out these finger-like projections called pseudopodia or false feet for the movement purpose, for the movement or the capture of the food. To capture the food, it lends out the feet-like structure for the capture of the food. Then it feeds on the web. Amoeba is usually a very small organism. It lives on the pond water and it further feeds on only microscopic organisms. It eats only microscopic organisms. With the help of a false feet or pseudopodia, it moves the false feet or pseudopodia outside and captures the food. The food gets trapped in a structure called food vacuole. Inside the body of the amoeba, there is a structure called food vacuole. That food vacuole contains digestive juices, which helps the food to get digested. So amoeba has a finger-like projection or pseudo feet called pseudopodia, which helps in movement and also in the capturing of the food. It lends out the pseudopodia, like a leg-like structure, it lends it outside whenever it gets food. The food is in the form of microorganisms only, which we can see only under a microscope. Whatever food the amoeba eats, this food gets trapped in a structure called food vacuole. Food vacuole has digestive juices in it, which helps in digestion of the food. So the digested food is absorbed by the food vacuole, and this food helps in maintenance, growth and multiplication of the organism. And the undigested food is also expelled outside via the food vacuole. This is about the digestion in amoeba, and this completes the chapter Nutrition in Animals.